This week, a rapid 24-hour period in the nation of Taiwan saw earthquake after earthquake after earthquake strike the country in rapid succession, all of which were large enough to feel and potentially cause damage. As, between 2:26 p.m. on April 22nd and 23rd, a small area of Taiwan saw 22 magnitude 5 quakes and 21 magnitude 4 quakes strike one after the other, with one magnitude 5.8 quake striking while the shaking from a smaller magnitude 4.8 earthquake was still ongoing. While these events could all technically be potentially classified as aftershocks of the destructive magnitude 7.4 quake which struck 3 weeks ago, they seemingly broke what was previously loosely following the expected slow but sure decrease in the rate of aftershocks. Not only this, but the sheer number of events, which were seemingly the same magnitude of 4.5 to 4.9 and 5.0 to 5.4, defied all expectations, even occurring at higher rates than their smaller magnitude cousins at a category lower. In fact, more magnitude 5 earthquakes occurred during that 24-hour-long time span than did as aftershocks in the same region across the prior 18 days. While aftershock sequences can be abnormal, there simply is no known existing historical parallel where a similar number of large aftershocks occurred after a main shockwave, with a cluster of more larger aftershocks of a certain size occurring than the expected higher rate of smaller magnitude aftershocks. So, why did so many earthquakes occur, and is there a danger of this happening again? After all, many residents who felt these recent sizable quakes had only just taken their minds off of worrying about a high risk of large aftershocks until the events of April 22nd and April 23rd. To answer the first question, and this might surprise some people, us scientists do not actually know why so many aftershocks of a similar magnitude struck in rapid succession. While it hypothetically could have been caused by random chance creating an unlikely distribution of data, I would like to suggest an alternate possibility. The first thing to note is that the 24 hours of intense activity had two larger quakes occur in the middle, registering in as magnitudes 6.1 and 6.0. While the quakes which struck after these could be better thought of as aftershocks of these magnitude 6 events rather than April 3rd's magnitude 7 event, there is also a slow, increasing near-continuous trend leading up to these quakes. These quakes and the 12 hours beforehand represent a fairly uncommon phenomena where an earthquake is followed by a larger quake in what is known as a foreshock. The chance that an earthquake of any magnitude being a foreshock to an even larger earthquake in the next 72 hours is only 6%, meaning that the vast majority of earthquakes do not have foreshocks. And yet, there was not simply one, but a palindrome-like increase before and decrease after the magnitude 6 event struck. However, the aforementioned irregular distribution of earthquake magnitude still remains when you break the events into foreshocks and aftershocks. One possibility is that the rupture of the longitudinal valley fault on April 3rd at 35 kilometers depth combined with the strain produced by aftershocks in the weeks since and took until the 22nd to reach such a level that it triggered efficient movement of either shallower sections of the same fault or a series of related parallel smaller faults. If smaller faults were the cause, they could exist as a series of segments of the same approximate length, meaning that maximum strain results in the entire rupture of these smaller faults, whose minimal length keeps earthquakes to mostly around magnitude 5. Thankfully, these earthquakes which struck on April 22nd and 23rd only caused minor damage, unlike the $1 billion in damage the stronger April 3rd earthquake caused. I expect the rate of aftershocks to rapidly decline across the next week, with a low possibility of a similarly strong repeat earthquake swarm occurring of the same intensity. As a final note, I would like to thank this channel's new patron, Eugene Barth, for supporting this channel.